Okay, good morning everyone. This is Samad here from WeBind Education Technologies, Mumbai. And as you know, WeBind is an industry leader like Apple Classrooms. And for today's session on how corporates expect your CVs to be, we have got Ms. Amrita Kole as a speaker for today. She's an independent writer with an experience of more than 5 years. So without any further delay, I invite Ms. Amrita to take the floor.
Thank you for the introduction, Samad. Good morning, friends. As rightly said by Samad, I'm here to give you insights on the topic how corporates expect your CV to be. So I'll just share my screen with you. Yeah, so resume, CV, biodata, as we say, just a second. Yeah, so resume, CV, biodata, as we say, it comes back in, it started the entire draft got its concept in the late 14th century when Leonardo da Vinci wrote the first piece of draft. And then with the evolution of technology, the resume also got its different kinds of shapes and names. So in India, it is there is no such distinction. In government sectors, we call it CV or biodata. But in general, we name it as resumes. Though there is a huge difference between a resume and a CV. A resume is a very brief, concise document. It is very to the point, and it is very, very professional. You don't write anything extra in a resume. But on the other hand, a CV is a detailed document. A CV contains all details related to your work experience, awards, any other information that you want, you can add in a CV. A CV is a bit lengthy than a resume. A CV can be of 2 to 3 pages, but a resume is strictly 1 pages or 1.5 pages. You don't write anything extra in the resume. So once you start applying for jobs in the international market, you will get to know the difference between a resume and a CV very clearly, because markets such as US, Germany, they prefer resumes. They will strictly ask you to submit resumes. But markets such as Australia, Dubai, India, they always prefer a CV. So I'll start with the first slide, importance of an eye-catching CV. Well, as I said, with the evolution of technology, when in the mid 19th century, all the job portals entered the market in India, job portals such as Monsters, Naukri, Times, they sort of build a bridge between the job seekers and the recruiters. And then in 2003, when LinkedIn was launched, LinkedIn is a social platform which connects professionals. So LinkedIn beautifully created a very nice bridge between job seekers and the recruiters. So with the demand, now people can directly apply for jobs using LinkedIn or directly send their resumes to the recruiters. So the demand of an eye-catching CV came into the picture, and so it was became very, very important that the person who is applying for a job, you know, presents a document which very well market his skills. So that is why it is very, very important to share a eye-catching CV. Also, now that the bridge was developed, it became a very hectic job for the HRs to, you know, review all the resumes. So what happens is you get only 20 to 30 second window to share your to make an impression to the recruiter. So that is why it is very important that the first part of your resume is very impressive, and then the rest part is very clear and easy readable. So that is why I have written some of the points that you can see. You can very well, you know, make the CV stand out. Now, in order to make the CV stand out, you have to be creative here. Now, since most of you are freshers, you don't have much achievements to write, or you know, since you don't have an industry experience, so what you can do here is whatever experience you gain from internships, from projects, you can highlight those things, or you can use those points to make the resume impactful. Now moving on to the next slide, that is common mistakes. Obviously, where human work is involved, mistakes are a common thing that happens. But in case of a resume, there is no window for a mistake, you know, because the recruiter don't have any much time and patience to sit and rectify those errors or to decode your resume as to what exactly you have written. There are very, very common mistakes that can be very well avoided if given a little thought. First of all, don't add any false information in your resume. See, the recruiter who would evaluate your resume, or the organization that would hire you, is very, very clever and smart. So there is no point in adding any false information, because as it is, once you are selected, your resume would or your profile would go for a background check. So if you by any chance add any false information, and then it would you know, give a very, very bad impression if you lie in your resume. Irrelevant content. Once I came across a profile in which the person wrote a complete paragraph about how he is unhappy with his life, and how he is you know, tortured at office. So just a second. Yeah. So that was considered to be a very irrelevant content, and it resulted in giving a very bad impression to the recruiter, and obviously his profile got rejected. Avoid using lengthy paragraphs. Don't use it. In some formats, yes, paragraph is asked for. Especially in the US, I have seen that, you know, in the summary portion, the summary is written in a paragraph, but limit your writing to just 2 to 3 lines, and try to bold the key points. Like if you're writing, you have a master's degree in XYZ, so highlight the master's degree, and then the second line, if you're writing that you're a good communicator, or you have done any achievement, highlight that important thing, bold it, or give an underline. This way, it does not become boring, and your key points get noticed in a paragraph. Not so professional language. See, there is a boundary, there is a line when it comes to professionalism. You know, you never know the recruiter is a girl or a boy, or what mentality that person has. So maintain a very, very strict and professional language in your resume. Don't write any jokes, don't write any slangs, nothing. You just stick to what you do, what your achievements are, and that's it. Give a plain, simple document. You don't have to sound cool in your resume that you can save for the interview part. Don't do it in a document. Spelling and grammar mistakes. Yes, you have to avoid being sloppy and cross-check it 1,000 times before submitting a resume. Also, since after reading a document again and again, it becomes very monotonous and our brains stop figuring out mistakes. So what you can do here is you can ask your friend to study your resume once before submitting, so that any last minute errors can be avoided. Bad photographs. Everybody is good looking and beautiful, but there is a line when you are posting a photograph in your resume. In India, we don't need a photographs in the resumes. But in some countries like Dubai, I have seen, US, I have seen, they ask for a photograph. Put a very, very professional photograph for your resume. Get it clicked by some professionals. Over expressive content. Now, what happens is when we write something, maybe if you're writing about an award that you might have won any award at anything, maybe a seminar or something. So just write that thing, one star of the year award. That's it. Don't extend it. Like, don't go in writing that so many people attended the award function. I received a standing ovation in that award. Don't do so. Because that way, nobody is going to read it that much, and then they will get a negative impression about you. Repetition. Strictly avoid repetition in your resume. If it is a very, very, very good achievement, then maybe you can use it twice, once in the summary and second in the somewhere down in the education section. But apart from then, don't just continuously write the same point again and again. This way, the impression that the recruiters get is you don't have much to talk about in your resume. So these are some of the common mistakes that can be avoided, and then a draft can be prepared, which would somehow save you from getting rejected. Next slide is about writing tips. These are some of the writing tips. Overusing of personal pronoun, I. See, we tend to avoid this thing, I, me, myself. It is not used in a resume because it is a professional document. And instead of writing I, you make it achievement oriented. Like if you are writing, I managed your team, maybe you're doing some project and you were the lead of the project. So you managed your team. So you don't have to write it. Rather, write it in an achievement-oriented form using action verbs, like simply write, managed a team. Because what happens is resume is a document which would speak about you in front of your recruiter. You are not personally speaking or you are not personally saying anything in a resume. The resume would speak for you. So it has to be in the third person tense. Never use any personal pronoun in a resume. It gives a very negative or bad impression. Okay. Then keep your sentences short. Right. Keep it as much concise as possible, because again, as I said, that the shorter it is, the better it goes. Nobody likes to read long sentences, and nobody likes lengthy things. Even if we see in our daily life, if we have to read a history chapter, or if we have to read a very, very 2-3 pages document about anything, we really get bored and we tend to skip and read it. So just because your important information do not get you don't miss your important information, you have to make your sentences very short. Proofread and cross-check all the facts till the last second. Sometimes what happens is we usually copy and paste information from using the internet. Now, if we don't cross-check it, what we are copying and pasting, then what happens is at the very last hour when we have circulated our resume and when we are being called for the resume, then at the just before the resume entering into the interview, we just notice some few things that are not at all relevant to our profile, and it is a very bad thing, because maybe the interview would cross check you on those points, or maybe he would ask you questions regarding those points. So it would give a bad impression and you wouldn't be able to answer it. So it's better to proof it as much as possible. And if you are not in a mood to proof it, then get your friends to proof it for you so that they can point out mistakes. And then when you are finally facing the interview or finally circulating your interview, you won't get embarrassed. So having said everything, now is the part that is most important, components of a CV. I have listed some of the basic components of a CV, keeping that most of you are freshers. So these are some of the components of a CV that goes to a fresher's resume. So I'll just do one thing. I'll share my screen. I'll share a developed resume with you, and I will explain each point. Okay, just a moment. Yeah, so here's the resume. I would always suggest you to start writing your resume from the end, like start from the personal details section. Now, if you're applying in India, then all you need to share in your personal details is date of birth, languages known, and address. That's it. If you're applying for some other country or other job market, then you have to read the JD very carefully and put the information that has been asked for. Like in some places, they ask for nationality, driving license, visa status. So you have to cross-check it. Then you write the education section. Just write your degree, MBA, or school details. Avoid school details if you are doing MBA. Write school details if you have achieved good percentage in that, or any scholarship that you have achieved. Then you can mention your school details, because it is very clearly understood that obviously you have passed your school, then only you are doing your graduation or MBA. So no need to add extra thing. Training courses, IT skills, projects undertaken, seminars attended, and then internship if you have done anything, because there are few person who gets, especially if you are doing an MBA, then maybe you have 1 or 2 years of work experience. So you can mention your work experience over here or your internship over here. Now if you notice the sample that I'm showing, this person has done some internship as a customer service representative. Now what I have done here is I have written only his highlights. I have not written about his responsibilities. The reason being, everybody has a basic idea as to what exactly a customer service representative does. So we don't need that in a resume. What we need here is what that person has done or has to offer as a customer service representative. Okay, so in the highlight section, if you read, he acted as a single point of contact, provided some solutions to the customer, interacted with clients, and display. And then since this guy wanted to apply for some IT job, I highlighted one IT point also, that when he was doing this job, he got hold of technical concepts very quickly. I did this very deliberately so that I can highlight that he always had interest in technical thing. And then again, when you are writing projects under the education section, write it very nicely. In case of freshers and in case of engineering student, this section is very important. So write the languages that you have used, the system that you have worked, or any technical environment that you have worked on. Give a project description And then write about the highlight. See, every project has some benefit. You know, there is a reason for developing that project. So write the highlight. Think about what you have contributed in that project. So think about that and then write it. In this case, that project that person has contributed to improve some of the major concerns in that project. So think on those lines and write it. In seminars also, give a very detailed description of what exactly the seminar was all about. And if also you can add one section here, about your key learning, what you learned in that seminar, that is more important. Then I will come to the summary part. This section is very, very important. So when I was working with GSR, we developed this format in which we highlighted the key work of the profile, and then we highlighted what are the skills that person achieved from that key work that he did. So now if you see, in the first line I have written, demonstrated excellent technical competency while using one of the most promising technology in the modern world, cloud computing. Now from where did I get this? I got this from the project. I noticed that this person has done the project, and the environment that he used was cloud computing. Now, I searched in Google. Cloud computing is a very promising technology nowadays. So I molded it and wrote it as his highlight that he has got excellent proficiency in using this cloud computing thing. And then I made this as a highlight. This was his highlight. And then if you see the competency displayed section, I showed that this person has good knowledge of web, software, and programming languages. So this way you can map your highlights and skills. This section is very, you have to give very, very detailed thought to develop this section. And once you are in the flow, then it won't be a very difficult task. And then the profile summary. The profile summary is basically some brief points that would talk about what you have done so far, what traits you have, personal or professional traits you have. So the summary would talk about that. Now, I have written 4 points in which I have highlighted his technical competency, I have highlighted his personal competency, I have highlighted that his ability to grasp unfamiliar technologies, and since he was working in that customer representative thing, so I wrote a point related to the same. In the summary, use those 3-4 points to summarize your entire experience. If you have done any projects, if you have done an internship, if you have experience in anything extra, so write it there. And then comes the core competencies. Core competencies are, if you notice that I have added keywords in, these are small keywords that I have added. If you are dicey about what keywords you can write here, so you can do one thing, you can pick up your subjects. And rather than core competencies, you can write here as knowledge of, let's say if you're from an electronics background, you can write about signals, or you can write about networks. You have good knowledge of networking, signals, strength, those subjects you can write here. What purpose this section would solve is, the more keywords you add in a resume, the more it comes up in the search thing. You know, when you upload a resume in any job portals, there is a ATS system that scans your resume. So it would pick up all the keywords and send your resume forward. If your resume don't have keyword, but you have the experience, but your resume don't have the keywords, then obviously ATS won't pick your resume and your resume would end up in trash. So keywords, I would recommend you to add as much keyword as you want. Don't repeat keywords. once or twice it is fine. In this section, don't repeat keywords. You can, if you can see that I have used software development here. I have used a different keyword, software engineer here. Again, if you will search, then you would find some software related to point in somewhere down below. So this way differently you can highlight keywords so that whatever keywords the person puts up in the search box, your resume gets pulled up. And then this is a very brief objective line. Try to make it useful. Like, see, I have written he is a computer science graduate who is seeking career enriching assignment as a Java developer, IT analyst, and software engineer. Now, this is very important. If you read the JD very carefully, the JD that you have, and then try to map yourself with the JD. If you are if you possess those ability or not. If yes, then only go and apply it. If not, then try to think that what are the skills you have so that you can apply for that job. So for that, you can use this section. If you don't have that JD, if your skills are not matching those JD, so you can use it. Okay, you can map your highlights and then map your skills accordingly. So this is a standard resume. You can use your creativity, you can use your layout, you can use any layout that the Google shows you, you can use it and you can make your CV, but I'm just showing you a standard sample here. Okay, I'll go back to the PPT. So this was all about the CV and then about a cover letter. A cover letter can be considered as a soulmate for the CV, you know, because what happens is CV is a detailed document, but before the CV, you can actually send a cover letter to the recruiter. What would happen is cover letter would speak about your briefly about your competencies. You know, you can make a cover letter very interesting and then you can arouse the interest of a recruiter. So cover letter can be used in multiple ways. Cover letter can be used as a mail body, as a mail template, and you can send it. And some companies specifically ask for a cover letter. So in that case, you have to prepare a very good cover letter and send it to the recruiter. Here is an example. The very first question that you should answer in a cover letter is, why should we hire you? This is very, very important. Okay, you have to answer this question in a cover letter. Why should we hire you? You have to highlight your skills. You have to tell them that you are important for them, what contributions you can make to the company. And then you have to tell them and then you have to write it in the cover letter. Attract the attention of a prospective boss. Attract the attention of the prospective boss. It is very important to grab attention. Okay, it is. So how can you grab attention? By telling them about the contributions you can make. Okay, and then here is an example. If you are doing an MBA, so you can write it here that you are that in addition to my current pursuit of MBA, I can also offer. And then you can list all the things that you can offer to that company. So this way you can make a cover letter to be very, very impactful. And then it would serve the purpose. Here is an example of an ideal cover letter. If you see, I have written it in a paragraph and then I have covered few points. And then I have written some paragraphs. Give a brief introduction about yourself. write highlights related to your profile. Highlight your education details. Try to map your skills with the JD and give a very professional closing statement. And the work of the cover letter is done. It is a very brief document with 2 to 3 paragraphs. Don't make it lengthy. Writing an email. Now it is very important when you are writing a resume and a cover letter, it is very important that you send a very professional email to the job seekers. So when you are writing an email, don't over communicate by email. Keep it very simple to the point. Like, for example, just write simply, "Dear hiring manager, thank you for contacting me. I would like to share my resume with you." And then give a brief about yourself, about your skills, and then close the mail. Don't write those lines like how you are so glad you got the invitation, or how you are so overwhelming or looking forward. Don't go for those things. Keep it very brief and simple. Make good use of subject line. Now this is a bit tricky because at times we wonder what exactly a subject line would hold. So what would happen is, what we can do here is write if you're applying for a job, then just simply write your name and write the purpose of your sending the mail. Simply write that you're applying for a job. That's it. For the position, you also mention the position name of the position that you're applying for. Keep your messages clear and brief, right? Like I said before, keep it very, very brief and to the points. And if possible, use bullets in your mail also. Don't go for lengthy paragraphs. Be polite. Now, there is a thin line between being polite and being rude. The way we communicate, at times, we can show our expressions by communicating, but what happens in mail is we don't send mail. And also in professional mails, we don't send smileys. We can't do that. So for that, you have to cross-check again and again if your tone is polite or not. Use words like "thank you," "would request you," "please," "kindly." Use these words as much as possible and make it very, very polite. Again, proofread your mail also. Whatever you do, you have to proofread it. There are some softwares available in the internet. Those softwares would check for spelling or grammar errors for you. You can download it and map it with your mail ID so that whenever you are sending a mail, they will proofread for you. And once that is done, you proofread it yourself before sending. And again, cross-check your tone when sending a mail. And never write a mail when you are angry, sad, or very happy. Don't write a mail. Always wait, calm down your emotions, then write a mail. Now the thing about resume is done, writing a mail is done. But ultimately our aim is to land, get to a dream job. So now, since most of your career would start, I would request all of you to join LinkedIn. Join LinkedIn and start making connections. Start networking in LinkedIn. I know at the starting of your career, most of you would get campus placement or would directly get any job. But it is always better somewhere later in your career stage when you will come, then you will understand the importance of LinkedIn as to how useful it is when you are connected with the right person. Join groups. In LinkedIn, there is an option to join groups. You will notice that there are various groups in which most of the HRs are connected. From leading companies, HRs are connected over there. Join those groups. And try to participate in the discussion. Once you're joining a group, you would see that every other day, HR or any other person is asking some questions related to professional thing or discussing any issue. So join in that discussion. Also keep in mind that LinkedIn is a very, very professional platform. Avoid posting your beautiful selfies over LinkedIn. Avoid posting those irrelevant pictures that we share in LinkedIn, those Matarani pictures that we, you know, like ask to like and share. Don't do so. Don't use it as a Facebook. That's it. Simple. Use it just for LinkedIn, for connecting to people. Because your social image is very important. Because somewhere later in your career stage, you will realize your mistake once you are doing that in the LinkedIn. The recruiter, once they see that how you are wasting your time in social networking, they would get a very bad impression about you. So don't do so. Then there is a section to add blogs in your LinkedIn profile. Blog as much as you can. Or if not in LinkedIn, then create a blog page separately. What happens for a blog page is it gives a recruiter impression about how educated you are in your stream, how well knowledge you possess in the stream. You can write anything, any blog in LinkedIn related to any field. Again, don't go for irrelevant content. Like, nobody is interested in knowing about Arvind Kejriwal or anything. Don't do so. Write, if you are from a technical background, write about tech stuff. If you are from a management background, write about management stuff. Or vice versa. But don't go for irrelevant political, social issues. As I said, networking is very, very important. Try to connect, and maybe you can connect with not HRs, but from senior engineers or senior management professionals from the industry. So LinkedIn is a very good platform to do so. Understand the JD very, very nicely. Once you get to apply, you are about to apply, read the JD 100 times before applying. I know at times very simple things are mentioned there that you should have good communication, interpersonal or interpersonal ability, but you have to read it and then decode it as to how you can map your highlights and and write your skills or highlight your skills. Maybe you can write, like, if you have any voluntary experience in colleges, you know, the volunteer, so you can write it that you have leadership ability, you have the ability to take charge and organize events, take charge and host an event. So you can highlight these skills in a resume. So this is how it goes. So I don't know how much you have understood, so I would request you to start asking questions to me so that this session can be as interactive as possible.
Thank you for the wonderful session. So, students, here is Amrita Kulle, who can any questions on CV writing or cover letter. And besides, Amrita will be writing your CV for free for the students who will be asking a particular question. So we have got limited time for asking a question, and whoever asks a question to Amrita, she will write her resume and cover letter absolutely free. Normally it is chargeable. So here you go. You can use the chat box to ask the question. Yes, do we have any questions?
Okay, I got one question from SV Institute of Management. in resume photograph is required or not? Well, it depends on the job that you're applying for. If the job is, if the requirement of the JD is asking for a photograph, then you give it, else you don't. In Indian market, it is not important to give a photograph. So in Dubai or in UAE, you have to give a photograph. Other than that, it is not important to add a photograph. And also, if you are adding a photograph, make sure that it is very, very professional. Don't just add anything in your CV. Okay, here is one interesting question. How do we compete with experience holders CV as we are freshers? Well, I don't think that there is any competition in CV writing when it comes for experience holders or freshers. You just have to highlight your skills, highlight yourself, and be confident that you are, you can do it and you are eligible for the job. You know, at times we have seen that freshers, some freshers are much knowledgeable and experienced than the, you know, the experienced person sitting over there. So you just have to be confident. Don't be overconfident, but be confident and highlight. Like I showed you the section wherein I have highlighted the key points and added the skills. So try to map it. Try to bring out as much value. Value add as you can. Try to show in your resume and cover letter the impacts that you have achieved and highlighted, and then don't worry about competition or anything. You will get through.
Sorry for the interruption. I would request all the professors to please note down the students' name so that we can have
the... How can we make our CV eye-catchy? Thank you, Palak, for asking this question. Well, for making the CV eye-catchy, there is a very simple thing, make it attractive. Then only you can make it eye-catchy, make it very neat, clean, concise, to the point, brief, and definitely it would catch a person's eye. And also you can Google out the layouts, and you can Google out, and you can use graphs or visuals or in, to highlight your important skills. That way it can, you can make it eye-catchy. Thanks, Vignesh, for asking this question. Yeah, cover letter is, as you said, cover letters in India is not that important. What you can do here is you can use the content of the cover letter to write a mail. While you are sending a professional mail, you can use the content of the cover letter and send it across. But in some companies, they would specifically ask you to share a cover letter. In that case, you have to share it, share a cover letter. You don't have any choice. So make it. Any other questions? Okay, Palak, JD is basically a job description that you get when a company gives an opening. They share a job description. It is a detailed description asking about, they are telling the, about their requirement, because every position has their own set of requirements. So a candidate has to fit in to that requirement and then only apply. So job description is basically nothing but a requirement that a company posts. How should we discuss about achievement? The question is coming from SV Institute of Management. Well, in a CV, try to discuss nothing else but achievements only. In the summary section, in the then after that the achievement section, then again in the projects, internship section. Write, think about what you have contributed so far. Since you are doing your engineering or management degree, you all possess some sort of experience. In engineering also, whatever projects or internships that you have done, write about your highlights only, and don't write anything vague, anything extra, or any generic content in your CV. Only write about your achievements. Try to use action verbs. You can Google it and you will get a very huge list of action verbs that you can use, and then use it to put it in the resume. Okay, Priyadarshini is asking, instead of writing so many texts, can I mention the name of my personal website? Yes, you can do so, but it is not guaranteed. Now, the recruiter sitting there, why would that person take the pain to, you know, log into that website and read everything? You can post the link at the top where you are sharing your contact details. You can put the link over there. But using a link instead of a resume is not a good idea. I don't think that is. For management student, what type of hobbies should be written? See, in some of the markets, they ask for hobbies. But in India, you can, if you're applying in India, you can skip the hobbies section. But if you are engaged in any sports activities, then you can mention it in the hobby section. The reason for doing so, because sports person are considered to be very active, and they have the potential or the stamina to, you know, give their 100%. So in that case, mention hobbies, otherwise you can skip it. Okay, Vishwajit, you have experience. You have 3.5 years of experience. You have the appointment letter, but you don't have the experience letter. So can I mention the experience? See, it's totally depends on the job that you're applying for. Some of the reputed companies won't consider your application or won't consider your experience if you don't have the experience letter. But if you're applying for startups or some very low profile companies, in that case, you can talk to the interviewer and you can mention your experience. Priyadarshini MBA College, from Priyadarshini MBA College, I'm getting a question. What font size and style to be used in a resume? See, as I said, that you have to be creative, and you have the liberty to be creative in a resume, so you can use any font or size. But the standard is use fonts such as Times New Roman, Arial, Calibri, or Cambria in a resume, and keep the font size between 10 to 14.
So I hope that answers your question. Do we have any more
questions,
students? Okay, let this be the last question.
Okay, Pallavi, a very good question you're asking. She's asking that, as you said in cover letter, contribution should be tell towards the company. Can you give example what contributions are to be made towards the company? Okay, so see, you have to map your highlights. I'm saying this again and again. You have to map your highlights with your JD. Like if you have done any projects, if you have taken any leadership decision, or if you have headed the team in that project. So you can map your highlight here with the skill, saying that you took this leadership responsibility in your college. And then you can say that you can contribute to the same to the company that you're applying for. So this way you have to think and list down your achievements and then map it with the job description. And she is also asking, while writing email, what to write before subject. Well, the subject would contain the job that you are applying for. It just has to consist of the word that you are applying for this particular job. You can use it as a subject line.
Thank you, Amrita, for the question and answer session. So we stopped the question and answer round here. And Amrita, if the students would want to get in touch with you for asking further more questions, can you please help us with your contact details?
Okay, so I think that was it. If you want to get connected with me for further engagement, so you can log on to amritakole.com and directly contact me. You can send your resumes to me for free evaluation, and for free guidance, you can contact me anytime. Thank you.
Thank you, Amrita. If you can please type it out. Students, you can have a look at the chat box. Thank you, Amrita, for sharing your time, your experience and knowledge about CV writing. And we are sure that the students learned a lot and they will be contacting you for further work. Students, can we have a huge round of applause for Ms. Amrita for sharing her time?
Thank you, everyone.
Just 5 minutes more. Professors, the students who have asked questions, please communicate with our campus department. Share details of the students and we'll have the CV ready for those students. Besides, I would request all of the students, if they haven't registered themselves on vbind.in, please visit our website, register yourself as a student, and avail the free certificate and other details. Besides, we are running a blog competition where the participants are bound to get a prize worth 1 lakh rupees. Please log on to our website, register yourself as a student, avail a certificate, and besides the gifts also. Thank you for being such a wonderful audience. Have a nice day.